Sorry? I will start. Okay. Hello, everyone. Welcome to this presentation about Joomla and the Raspberry Pi. Before we start, who in this audience has a Raspberry Pi already? Okay. And what are you doing with it? Smart TV. Okay, nice. In this presentation, I will demonstrate how to use the Raspberry Pi as a web server. This is the overview of my presentation. First, I will just do something with the Raspberry Pi, with the operating system. And then I will install Joomla. And I will end with some points about performance and security. So, for the people who don't know the Raspberry Pi yet, it's a nice small computer which is meant for education. In the UK, there was someone who noticed that a lot of engineers of these days, they used to get programming classes on the home computers like this one. This is the BBC microcomputer. It has a processor which is an early version of the ARM chip, which is in the Raspberry Pi. What I thought was, the youth of today, they learn how to swipe or to click menus during automation classes, but they don't know the fundamentals anymore. So therefore, they came up with this small device, the Raspberry Pi. It's very cheap if you compare it with other machines. There are no moving parts in it, so you can use it as a web server, and that's what I want to do in this session. There is much documentation about it. There is also a lot of software available for it because it's just using Linux. And these are the specifications. And if you look at it, I will only use the SD card, the micro USB for the power, and Ethernet for my Raspberry Pi if it's a web server. There is a large community around it. A lot of users. There is a lot of software available, I already told that. And there is also additional hardware available for this machine, like a GERD board, a sort of board which you can put on it, and you can control stuff in your house, or moving, how do you say it, motor coils or something. Or there is a USB camera which you can put on it. There's also a lot to do about the case, because when you buy it, you just receive this, and there's no case. And, well, you should not put it on something from iron, otherwise you will get a short circuit. So therefore, people start to make cases. There are a lot of 3D projects, but also this project. It's, I think, a 9-year-old girl from or Germany or England, I forgot. And she created an open source Lego case. You can download the instruction on the internet and do it yourself. So I want to do something different. So therefore, I didn't use Lego. I have two kids. They are not in the Lego phase yet. They are in the Duplo phase. It's the other stuff. So therefore, I just created my own case with it. The fun part, I will install Joomla on it. But that's not all. I have to install Linux. When it's installed, I have to do something with the performance of the machine because it's not really, really good. And of course, with every machine you put on the internet, you have to do something with security. Because we don't want these kinds of stuff on our machines. Well, my version is even better than this girl's ones, because I have alarm on it. This hasn't that something like that. So now, mine is portable. Yeah, that was it. So, yeah. So, what I want to do, I want to create a web server of it. So you need a LAMP stack. Well, Linux is, of course, the Debian version, which is available for this Raspberry Pi. But instead of Apache, I decided to use something else. First, I did it with Apache, but it was a bit slowish. Then I discovered Nginx, and I really love Nginx. I will show you in a minute. You know Nginx? Yeah. So this operating system, first of all, how to install it. Then I will connect it to the internet, to the network. I will update the operating system, do a backup of the card, do some configuration stuff, and I finally have to do something with the internet access to make it available for the outside world. So first, the installation. You go to the website of the Raspberry Pi organization, and you go to downloads, and you download the latest Raspbian version. And in this case, it's the one from 26th of July. You have to unzip it, and then you have to get it on this SD card. So there are some tools for it. One is called DD, which means dump disk or something. Some people say data destroy, because if you're not careful, you can destroy your hard drive if you select the wrong device. There are a couple of parameters, BS, EF, and OF. And first of all, you have to know what's the address of your SD card when you insert it in your computer. So first, what I did was I used a Linux command called dmesh. On Apple, it's the same. You just insert this card, you do again dmesh, and then you see a new device. And in this case, the device was called MMCBLKO, I think. Probably, yeah. Thank you. So with Linux, I use this command. And if you're a Mac or a Windows user, it's just with slight changes in it. So this is what I did on my Linux machine. And about 4.5 minutes later, this 8 gigabyte SD card has a 2 gigabyte image on it. So I'm missing about 6 gigabytes. Just doesn't matter. Because when I connect it to the internet, I mean to the network, I can do stuff with it, and I can use all the memory on it. So if you connect a device to to your local area network, how would you know the IP address of it? Has anyone an idea what you can do to find the IP address of your Raspberry Pi when you connect it? Because there is no display on it. It doesn't have a default IP address, because it's DHCP by default. So, yes?
Just using the router?
Yes.
Yes,
exactly. That's a good trick. I didn't use that. I started with this. on Android or iPhone, there's something called Overlook Thing, and you can see all the devices which are on your network. And the Raspberry Pi is announcing itself as Raspberry Pi Foundation. So this is what I used. But you can also use something called Nmap, but you have to install it first. And then with Nmap and your local area, and the last digits you change for /24, and then you have the whole area, and it will just show you everything what's in the network. But what you just told about using your router, so you go to the web server of your router, and there you look for it, yeah, it's a good idea. So, it was 16, number 16. So I have to go log in on number 16. And you log in on a Raspberry Pi using SSH. If you are on Windows, you use PuTTY or something, and then you do SSH, the name of the user, which is called Pi, and then add the IP address of your Raspberry Pi. First time you get a question if it's safe, if you expect this kind of string. Yes, I said. And the password, the default password of the Raspberry Pi, is Raspberry. So I logged in, and this was the message I got. And here you can see I'm logged in as Pi at Raspberry Pi. This is the name of the device. And you see a dollar sign. And the dollar sign means I'm logged in as a normal user. If you're a root, you will see a hashtag instead. So first of all, I run a command, which is sudo raspi config. Sudo is a command in Linux to run a command as super user. So you see I am just a regular user, but I am running this command as a super user. These two things I did, expand rootfs. So instead of the 2 gigabyte, my Raspberry Pi managed to make available all the memory on it. And because I use my Raspberry Pi as a server, I don't need any monitor to it. So I don't need the GPU. So I shrank the RAM GPU to 16 or 8 megabytes, so I had more memory for my Raspberry Pi itself. I rebooted, sorry? Oh, it's just a configuration option in Raspberry Pi. You have to update the software. First of all, sudo again, and with apt-get update, you update the repository on your machine. It synchronizes with a remote repository. And with the apt-get upgrade, you really upgrade everything on the Raspberry Pi. If you have an old image, if you use an old image, it will take a lot of time to do the upgrade. When you have done that, you just remove it. Just shut down your Raspberry Pi. You can also say reboot and just take out the power plug. To make a backup, just remove the SD card and do a command like this. So it's first vice versa, but be careful with this, with DD. So I didn't like this Raspberry Pi hostname. It's a bit too long, I think. So I decided to change it. I had to configure the hostname in this file. Nano is a sort of editor, a really simple editor. It's easy to use than Vim for people who just start with this. And faster also, okay. I changed Raspberry Pi to RPI. And also in the etc hosts, and notice it says 1.1 instead of 0.1, which you would expect. This is not a fault. You have to restart your Raspberry, the hostname process, and sometimes it's maybe easier to restart your Raspberry Pi. What I had to do was I wanted to change the Pi user to Peter because I don't like to be called Pi. So even if I have a Pi, I would like to be Peter. So what I did was I activated the root user. I added a password. I logged out. And I logged in again as the root. Here, root, and then the name of the machine. With a couple of commands, I changed the user Pi to Peter. And I also create a home directory for my own user. When you have done this, the best thing to do is test your account first before you close it, the SSH root access. First, open a new SSH connection to your Raspberry Pi. You log in with your new user. Now I'm Peter. I do a command with sudo, and this is only for super users. And with sudo, you have to add your password. So I tried my password, and it worked okay. So then I just disabled the root. When you buy it, well, the machine is from the UK, and here and in Holland, we live in another time zone, so we have to reconfigure the time zone, just a command, and then you have a select list. And then you're ready to go and to connect it to the internet. However, if you have a local network, people from the internet have to access your Raspberry Pi on your local network, so you have to do something with your router. For this example, I used Linksys. I have a domain name called petermartin.nl, and I want to connect it to my router. And in a router, I have to do something that the traffic from outside will go inside to my Raspberry Pi. However, this Raspberry Pi has a DHCP, which means when I turn it off and turn it on again, it might get another IP address. I don't want that, so I want to have it fixed. So first of all, I had to know what my IP address was. So with the browser, you go to whatsmyip.org. you see your IP address, which is in this case 1234. I go to my domain name panel, and I changed DNS, and I create a new A record, which points petermartin.nl to my new IP address. So if someone says in his browser petermartin.nl, they go to my router. Then in my router I had to do something, which I will show in a minute. And my router has an IP address, which is 192.168.0.1. And my Raspberry Pi, I wanted to have the fixed address, which is 9. So first of all, in my router, I created a couple of port forwarding requests. These three ports are forwarded. So 22 is SSH, 80 is, of course, the web server, and 443 is HTTPS. And my Raspberry Pi, to make it static, you just use the command route, and then you get some information, and this information you use in the network interfaces, because this is the file where you configure the Raspberry Pi, its IP address, the name, etc. So instead of DHCP, which is automatically, I change it to static, and I add some static information. So now my Raspberry Pi is ready to go. And we'll go to the next part of it, Nginx web server. Who doesn't know Nginx? Good. Great.
One question.
Yeah?
You told that you change your A record of your domain name, but usually we in Germany we have also the HTTP addresses from our provider, so it won't work. Next time you log in with the router to your internet provider,
then use no IP.
Yeah, or just like.
Oh, it's not. Well,
so
sorry.
It will not work on most of the internet connections.
I understand. Actually, we have a dynamic IP address as well, but it never changes. But it is dynamic. Maybe if I go on holiday for 2 months or so, then it can.
Are you really sure that it changes every 24 hours? No,
every 24 hours.
Is it because of privacy issues? Because it's good. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so thank you. I didn't know that.
Just for info.
Yeah, it's good to know. Well, Nginx. I think it's the same here as in Holland, Nginx. Nginx is really great. I mean, it's faster than Apache. Did I say faster? It's faster than Apache. You can. I think the configuration is more easy than Apache. And you have some extra possibilities like reverse proxy capabilities. Some people knew it already, some people didn't. And the people who knew it, maybe you know it because there are a lot of websites using it already. Apache is number one with the busiest websites, the top million, and Nginx is number two. It's even more popular than Microsoft. But if you look at all the websites, then Microsoft is still more popular. So who is using Nginx? Yeah, and besides you? These companies are using Nginx. Well, Facebook, we all know, Cloudflare. Some might know DB8. I know. And all those companies. So how to install it? You have to use sudo again, apt-get, and then install Nginx. You get some questions, just yes, and then it sets it up. By the way, the sheets will be available, so I will go fast, but you can reread it if you want to. Sorry? Yeah, but yeah, okay, good. So when you install it, you have to change something. By default, the configuration files of Linux are in a folder called etc, and in this case, Nginx, and then the Nginx configuration. One thing which you have to change, this is by default, I think, 2 or 4. This number has to be equal to the number of CPU processors you have in your device. So Raspberry Pi has only one CPU, so change it to 1. And with this command, you will start the Raspberry Pi. And if it works okay, you will see something like this. Welcome to Nginx. I know you know welcome to Apache or something, or success. This is the same with Nginx. Then you have to create some virtual domains. In my case, I wanted to have a domain called Peter Martin. So I created a var www because I like this kind of location, petermartin.nl, and then I created a website, an index.html. I created a configuration for my virtual domain. I created a symbolic link to activate it, the configuration. And I had to reload the configuration so that Nginx knew everything about my new site. So first of all, I created an index.html. This is this file, just HTML. And I say, welcome to Joomla Day Germany. This is all. Again, I used Nano with it. Then I had to create the virtual domain configuration. This is what you have to do. This is JSON style. That means you have those brackets, curly brackets. And within this curly bracket server, it's everything for my server. In this case, I listen to port 80, so to the regular web port. My server name is petermartin.nl or www.petermartin.nl. In real life, I will change this. I will change petermartin.nl to redirect it to this one or vice versa. I have to declare the root folder, which is, in this case, petermartin.nl on the var www folder. To create access logs and error logs is the best thing to do when you start with this, because you will run into errors, and here you can find what you did or what went wrong. Location, you have to create this block. And if someone goes to your website, these are the default files that are searched for and presented to the user. So now I have my sites available, virtual domain, but I have to make it site enabled as well. To do that, just create a symbolic link. The symbolic link is called sites enabled, and it will refer to sites available Peter Martin. And when you have done this, just reload the Nginx configuration. If you made a mistake, it says error. You have to change something. And if you if it's okay, then it will use it. But if there's an error in it, it won't use it. So the same, welcome to Joomla Day Germany. And if there's an error like Nginx, 404 not found, just check your log file. So this is just a regular website, but we all use Joomla with a database and with PHP. So first I will install a database. In this case, I chose for MySQL, but I could have chosen for MariaDB or something, because it's the same. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, SQL Lite, you can't use it with Joomla. No? No, okay. Therefore, I chose for MySQL. When you install MySQL, you have to run one command to make it secure afterwards, because it has a default user and some other stuff you don't want in your live website. So this is what I did again. Sudo apt-get install MySQL server. Not MySQL, but MySQL slash bracket server. And afterwards, this MySQL secure installation command, and then it's secure. So PHP. PHP is more difficult because with Apache you have a module, or you can use it as CKI module. With Nginx, you should install it as PAP, a fast CGI process manager module. So you have to install PHP 5 FPM. And also, it should communicate with the MySQL database, so you have to install this module. And on my screen, these two are gray. Here, they're just black. You don't need those two, but those two are fun. I mean, if you want to run PHP from the command line, you need this one. If you want to do stuff with Joomla updating or with, like I did, scrape websites, analyze websites, you have to install PHP 5 CRL curl. So this is how you install PHP 5 FPM and also the MySQL module. Just with this command, and it will restart the PHP module when it's installed. So it doesn't work yet because we only installed it and we have to we change the configuration of Nginx to work together with PHP because it doesn't know it yet. So this is what we do. We have to change our virtual configuration file again and we have to add a location. The old location we still have, but we added this location with a couple of lines. The PHP files will now be parsed or be given to PHP FPM, and that will render the PHP in it, and then it will return. So you have to test it. I like to test it with the PHP info command, so I see all the information of my configuration. And, well, you know, I changed my Raspberry Pi to the default address 09. So this is my address to get to test it. PHP MyAdmin. Today, Dave Hurley showed in a session something about MySQL Workbench. Okay, I'm still using PHP MyAdmin. So I installed PHP MyAdmin on this server. But you have to be careful with it. If you install it and you have multiple virtual domains, it's no use to add it to every virtual domain because if you add it to one virtual domain, you can use it for the other databases as well. Furthermore, I would recommend to limit the IP address. Oh yeah, sorry, no. You have a different IP address all the time. Well, I recommend it myself in Holland with my fixed IP address to make it only available for my own machine. And I don't know how you should do it here. We might discuss it later, this. So sudo apt-get get install and then php myadmin. You get some questions. I don't want to reconfigure it automatically, yeah?
I can still restrict it to one domain in the local network.
Yes, but then you can't go from here to show your database. You can't log in from outside.
So PHP admin does not have to be accessible from outside.
It can be handy sometimes. But yeah, you're right. Okay, you just install it. And then you have to make available this PHP MyAdmin in your virtual configuration file again. And it's some more information. Sometimes you will see in documentation or tutorials that some people will use the fast CGI pass and then the port, the local IP address, port 9000. Other people use the PHP 5 FPM SOC. I recommend using this. The other one, I just commented it, so you can see the difference. But I will, it's better to do it like this. And something else, my PHP files are not in my www root, no. They are in my user share, and therefore I define the root like this. And this is how to limit it to an IP address, to my own IP address, which is 1234. And that's it, and then it should work. So, first of all, before we start Joomla, we have to install create a database, and then we install Joomla. So you can use wget to get Joomla directly from the server. We have to install a database. In this case, I call my database Peter Martin. And when we download Joomla and unzip it, we have to start a browser and just do a manual installation. So this is what I did. I did cd to my home directory. I used wget, and I didn't type this. It's no use, you just go to the website of Joomla, you say copy a hyperlink, or copy save as, or something, and I just pasted it here. When you paste something in your terminal, you can't use Control V, but you have to use Shift Control V, and then you can paste it here, or maybe the right button. I unzipped it, and then I used the web installer. You might have a problem with the configuration file because it's not writable. As you know, at the end of Joomla, at the process, you if it's not writable, you get all the information, you copy it in the configuration file yourself, or you have to give the right permissions, and you do it with this command, chown, change ownership. When you install Joomla, you want to have search engine friendly links, but HDAccess is only for Apache, so we have to solve it. And in Nginx, you just solve it by this line of code, and you put it in your location, and then everything will be search engine friendly fully. There is no index.php in your URL anymore. Okay. Are there any questions so far? Okay, it's a lot of information. Yeah?
Just as a tip, in the Joomla wiki, there's a complete configuration of the role for Nginx, so you can just copy it.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Yeah, cheers. Performance. This Raspberry Pi is not really, really fast, I have to admit. It's 700 megahertz. And if you have it at home, you also have to take into account the speed of your internet connection. I mean, if you have a high performance website and you are downloading some legal movies, I mean, Rip the Remix Manifesto or something, you can illegally download that. People are getting on your website. It's, yeah, I think they will run in a server error or something. So you have to do a lot about the performance. Besides visitors, Google also takes into account the speed of your website. So there are different types of methods you can use to test your speed. And in this case, I did it scientifically incorrect by using Joomla debug and just used refresh, refresh, refresh. I changed things, refresh, refresh, refresh. And I just note down the speed things. You can also use browser plugins like YSlow. So the first time I switched on the debug mode, I went to profile information and I noticed that a regular Joomla page takes about 2.8 seconds to load. I don't know, I think it's not really that fast, 2.8 seconds, almost 3 seconds. So what I tried and what didn't work is this. Joomla gzip. Nginx has gzip on by default. So if you configure it in Joomla also to use gzip, and you don't have any speed in performance increase. There are a couple of really nice plugins like JCH Optimize, JBetolo, and Jerio Script Merge. Really nice, but I prefer to do it by hand and combine everything because I think if you use these kinds of scripts, they have to they run all the time, and if I do it manually, then it's just okay and it will be served like I want to. Memcached is very nice if you use it on the server. On my server, it didn't do much. Overclocking, I will show it in a minute. It takes about 1 millisecond or something, so I didn't use it. Or cryogenics, I will come to that later. First of all, Raspberry Pi config. By default, it says 700 megahertz, and you can switch it to 1,000 megahertz. It's a nice increase, but it didn't work very much. Then I thought about cryogenics. There is, if you know science, you know superconductivity. If you lower the temperature really low to the absolute zero, you will get superconductivity. So what if I would use it on my Raspberry Pi? Well, I don't have superconductivity in home, and so I have a fridge. My wife was not really glad with it because all the wires were out of the fridge. The Raspberry Pi is really small, but I can have an extra beer in my refrigerator, so I took it out. Then I didn't know if I should buy liquid nitrogen, or a liquid helium. So I decided just to not use this kind of stuff. And I did other stuff. Oh, here, there's overclocking. First of all, 0.6. When I did overclocking from 700 to 1,000 megahertz, it was 0.5. This is not the real statistics, but it was after I did other things, which helped a lot. So what helped? Well, first of all, Nginx with FPM, using the Unix socket. Joomla cache is great, but be really careful with progressive cache. I have this customer. He has a website with a lot of users, and he called me a bit in panic. Yeah, Peter, I have this login form with a CAPTCHA, and it looks okay, but if you do refresh, then you get the image. You can't read the image anymore. There is no image anymore. So it's broken. What did you do? Yeah, nothing. Just one at a time, just nothing. So I looked into his configuration, and then I found out that the configuration was set Joomla cache to progressive caching. So I phoned him. Did you change anything with the cache? Yeah, because caching is good, isn't it? But it is good, but you have to do other things. Otherwise, you will mess up these kinds of things. Nginx has gzip by default, so it helps. And also, you can cache files. For instance, the PDF or your ICO, your small favicon. And APC, I don't know if anyone knows APC. It's terrific. It is fast. It's sort of, I will show the statistics, the non-scientific statistics. First of all, FPFM, I read something about the difference between those two. It says that it's 10 or 15% faster, which is not really that much, but, well, I use this anyway. Joomla cache, this is really a huge performance increase. Before, its own a website is 2.7 seconds, and after Joomla cache, not a progressive, but a conservative, it's only 1.4. So this was a major improve. Nginx, gzip. In this file, you can set some gzip settings. Gzip on is already there. And some other I just added. Caching files. You put this in your configuration file of your virtual host. For instance, you say all PDFs are will expire in a year. So, yeah. APC, this is difficult. If you want to have APC on your website, on your Raspberry Pi website, you have to install Pear. Pear is a library for PHP. And you have to install it first before you can install APC, because it has something called PACL or something. This is what you have to do. And then it doesn't work, because I found it out after maybe an hour or so. You have to restart PHP FPM as well. I mean, just restart an Nginx doesn't start this one too. So you have to restart both, and then the performance gain is from 1.4 seconds to 0.7. So you will make it by half. So now my Raspberry Pi is serving pages instead of 3 seconds, maybe almost 1 second. So it's good. But I don't know if any of you has a computer on the internet. I mean, a web server on the internet. And if you look at the statistics of your log files, it scared me the hell out of me when I looked at it. Some security tips. Change your default username, because Pi is really common on a Raspberry Pi. So now it's Peter. Well, now you know, so I have to change it to something else. Backup, of course. Study the log files regularly, and you can use stuff like LogWatch. I have another server, it's a VPS, I use Nginx as well. I installed LogWatch, and every morning I get a small log file with all the login attempts. So if it's really long, then I have to do something about it, or, yeah. The block to SSH root login. Block port scans, I will show it in a minute. Script kiddies, you don't want those, I will show that too. And some other stuff which is useful. When you use SSH on a web server, there is a log file called auth.log, authorization.log. And when you look at it, you will see failed password, possible break-in attempt, and and really a lot. So the first thing I did was, this IP address, what's it? Where are they from? China, this one is from China. What I was told is, if you have break-in attempts, don't bother. I mean, bother only with the security, don't bother with reporting those. Only if they are at the university, because universities take care of their network. So if it's a university, maybe you can do a report abuse. I just installed a firewall. The default firewall for Linux is iptables. And when you do sudo iptables L, it lists all the rules you have in your firewall. This is just an empty firewall. I don't do anything now. So I have to create some rules. To create some rules, I created this file. And in this file, I pasted this page and this page. I found it on the internet. You have to be careful with stuff you find on the internet, so I have to look into it again when I have more time. But there are some configurations, especially for your IP tables you can use. You have to take into account that if you create such rules and you put it into your IP tables, you reset your Raspberry Pi, or you reboot it, you will lose all the rules in your IP tables again. So what you have to do, you have to create a sort of file, and you have to put it in, these are my rules, and here I put it in my IP tables, restore. Then it's in my IP tables, but to have it automatically in my IP tables, I created a file, which is in my if pre-up firewall. This is a small bash script, or it's a shell script. And here I just put the, my configuration into the firewall, and then it's okay. And here I make it executable. And now when I reboot my web server, all those firewall rules are in my IP tables. So I can add IP addresses to my firewall. However, to do that manually, it's a bit of much work, so you can automate it. There's a program called fail2ban. It's excellent, yes?
5 minutes ago.
5 minutes? Okay. Yes, I can do that. So, fail2ban is really marvelous. It's incredible. Because you can create a jail configuration. In the jail configuration, you say, I have a filter. And if this filter, if some entries in my log file are the same as in the filter for a couple of times, then do something with it. So what I did was I created the filter. First I installed fail2ban. Then I looked at fail2ban.log. There was nothing in it. And I get these kinds of log files on my web server. So woot, I don't know what it is, so I looked it up. People are trying typo.dreal on my Joomla web server, or XAMPP, or even WP login. So all those kinds of stuff I don't want. So I created a filter which I called woot configuration. This is my filter. If some entry in my log file has something like woot in it, setup.php WP login, then they will get banned, but not permanently. Because if I tell it here, that I do this. And someone of you thinks, I want to be funny. I go to Peter Martin's website. I do Wood in the URL. Then I can't show my website to anybody here. So therefore, I have a Jill for only 600 seconds, so 10 minutes. You can't do it. If you do one Wood, you will be banned for 10 minutes. If you do something like this, you have a restart fail to ban, and then it works. This is it. I didn't mention one thing. If you use Joomla on your Raspberry Pi, and you want to use Joomla's contact form, or maybe use a password sent method, or if you want to use LogWatch, which will email you the results, it doesn't, because you don't have a mail server on your Raspberry Pi. A mail server can be really big, so what you can do is XMTA, it's a mail transfer agent, and you can install it and configure to send all the email to a certain email address. And that's just it. Any questions? Any questions? Okay.
I have a question. Have you made that an image for your entire installation, including everything?
Of Joomla or what? Of what?
Yeah, for the entire Raspberry Pi, because you've done a lot of setup work throughout the process. Have you made that an actual image that could be then installed upon another one?
Yes, I created. In my presentation, you noticed that I said create a backup, and when I showed you, I created a backup.
Yeah.
And after all the other things, I didn't create a backup.
Yeah.
I should do that. Yeah. Yeah. Other questions? Yes. For me, it's an educational tool. I mean, with this, I improved my Linux skills. I improve my command line skills. That's my practical reason. But I use a Raspberry Pi at home as a jukebox. I installed MPD on it, Music Player Daemon. And I had also a PHP on it, on one. And I installed, I created a script which went to a certain website, for instance, a website with gold prices. And every hour it went back to the same site, just scraping the prices, put it in a MySQL database, so I could have a statistics of the gold prices. It was just because it's possible, because you can. Yeah, but a couple of months ago, someone asked me, could you help with me to get all the information of 7 different local venues for the concert agenda. I want to put those in one database. Could you do that? Yes. Apparently, they had XML files, which you could just read. But if they wouldn't have those, we could have solved it with a scraping script on a Raspberry Pi, for instance. Because, it's low power, no noise. It can run in the background. It does it every hour or what you want. But you have to do something with cron tabs. To run your PHP scripts. And you have to install PHP CLI and PHP curl. Yes, that's it. Okay, thank you.
How about the temperature of the device?
Good question.
If you stack 20 of them on
you can buy heating cooling fans, passive ones. So you just put it on 2 of the chips. On YouTube, there's a video of someone, and he got six degrees Celsius of his temperature. Not really that much, but I think it was 42 degrees or so. It's not really hot.
Okay.
But if you put 20 on it, I don't know. Maybe you better do it like this instead of this, because the heat will go up. Yeah.
But Lego won't melt.
No, actually. When I go back home, I have to give this back to my children, and then I will just use this one. But this is just for fun. It's nice to play with. It's the only time I can play with Duplo. Okay, thank you.